Chapter 3, An Enormous Monster. I debated for a long time what to do next. Should I hide out and play it safe? Or go on down to the chicken house and get blamed for something I didn't do? Curiosity got the best of me, so I trotted down to see what was going on. Drover was already there when I arrived, wagging his stub tail and trying to win a few points with his loyal dog routine. I walked up to him, I said out of the corner of my mouth, "Thanks for all the help this morning, really appreciate it." I think he missed the irony, because he said, "No, I mean," with a straight face. He said, "Well, it's okay, Hanky, it wasn't nothing." Dang right it wasn't nothing. Loper was kneeling over the hen studying the sign. Sally Mae stood nearby, looking mighty unhappy about that dead chicken. Loper pushed his hat on the back of his head and stood up. His eyes went straight to me and Drover. Only when I glanced around, I noticed Drover had disappeared. It was just me standing in the spotlight. "Hank, if you hadn't been out barking all night, you might have prevented this. Why do we keep you around here?" I hung my head and tucked my tail. "You have any idea how much money it costs to keep you dogs around here? Seems that every time I turn around, I'm buying another 50-pound sack of dog food, and that stuff's expensive." Maybe this ain't the time or the place to argue the point, but just for the record, let me say that Co-op dog food is the cheapest you can buy. I don't know what they make it out of, hulls, straw, sawdust, anything pigs won't eat. And when they throw in a little grease and called so-called flavor, it tastes like soap half the time. Gives me an upset stomach. The point is, I wasn't exactly eating this ranch into bankruptcy, though I thought I'd throw that in to give a more balanced view of things. Loper went on. "We can't afford to keep you dogs around here if you're going to let this sort of thing go on. Everybody has to earn their keep on this ranch. I don't want it to happen again." What do you suppose I wanted? Sometimes I don't understand. Oh, well. He picked up the dead chicken by the feet and carried it down to the trash barrel. Gotta admit that I watched this with some interest, since it occurred to me that there wasn't much any of us could do for a dead chicken. The more I thought about chicken dinner, the more my mouth watered. Couldn't get my mind off it. I like chicken about as well as any food you can name. Has a nice clean taste, except for the feathers. Feathers are pretty tasteless, if you ask me, and they kind of scrape when they go down. I sure was hungry for chicken, but I decided against it. Wouldn't look too good if I got caught eating the murder victim after all the trouble I'd gotten in that day. I tried to concentrate on the scene of the crime. I studied it again, went over the ground and sniffed it out. Nothing. No clues, no tracks, no scent. Could have been coyote, a coon, a skunk, a badger, even a fox. There was one thing I was sure of. It wouldn't happen again. Not while I was in charge of security. Not as long as I could stand up and fight for the ranch. I saw a Drover peek his head out of the machine shed. "Get some sleep, son," I told him. "Tonight we throw up a double guard. We could get ourselves into some combat." We slept till dark. When the moon come up, we went out on patrol, made several laps around headquarters. Everything was quiet. Off in the distance, we heard a few coyotes, but they weren't anywhere close. Must have been after midnight when Drover said his feet hurt. He wanted to rest a while. So I left him in front of the chicken house and told him to sound the alarm if anything unusual. I went down and checked things out at the corral. Made a circle around the place and ended up back at the chicken house about a half hour later. Thought I'd drop in unannounced, check up on Drover, make sure he was taking care of business. As I snuck up on him, I could see him in the moonlight. His ears were perked. He'd take about two steps and pounce on something with his front paws. Then he'd take two more steps and pounce again. He wasn't paying a lick of attention to the chicken house. A guy could have driven a truck in there, loaded up all the hens, and begun before Drover ever got the news. I walked up behind him. "What you doing?" He screeched and headed for the machine shed. I called him back. He came out looking all around with big eyes. Is that you, Hank? Uh-huh, what you doing? Me? Oh, nothing. That's when I saw the toad frog jump. Playing with the toad frog? On guard duty? When we got a murderer running around on the loose? He hung his head and went to wagging that stub tail of his. Well, I got bored, Hank. Sit down, son. Me and you need to have a serious talk. He sat down and I marched back and forth in front of him. Drover, I'm really disappointed in you. When you came to this ranch, you said you wanted to be a cow dog. I had misgivings at the time. I mean, you don't look like a cow dog, but I took you on anyway. Tried to teach you the business. Can you imagine how it breaks my heart to come up here and find you playing with a dadgum toad frog? His head sunk lower and he started to sniffle. If you had gone into any other line of work, playing with a frog would be all right. But a cow dog is something special. You might say we're the elite. We have to be stronger, braver, and tougher than any other brand of dog in the world. It's a special calling, Drover. It ain't for the common run of mutts. He started crying. Drover, there's only one thing that keeps you from being a good cow dog.
What is it, Hank?
You're worthless.
Oh, no, he squalled. Don't say it hurts too much.
It's true. I tried to be patient. I tried to teach you. I tried to be a good example.
I know.
But it hasn't worked. You're just as worthless today as the first time I saw you. You're a chicken-hearted little mutt. Is what you are. I don't think you'll ever make a cow dog.
Yes, I will, Hank. I just need some time.
Nope. Duty is duty. Got no choice but to let you go. He broke down and sobbed.
Oh, Hank. I got no place to go. No friends, no family. Nobody wants a chicken-hearted mutt. Give me three more chances.
Can't do it, Drover. Sorry.
Two more. No, one. One more.
I paced back and forth. It was one of the most difficult decisions in my career, and I didn't want to rush into it. All right. One more chance. But one more dumb stunt and you're finished. And I mean forever. Now dry your eyes, shape up, pay attention. To business. Concentrate on being unworthless.
Okay, Hank.
He started jumping up and down, going around in circles. You won't be sorry. No more frogs for me. I'll guard the chicken house and give my life if necessary. That's the spirit. I'm going to make the rounds again. If you see anything suspicious, give a holler. I started off on my rounds and left him sitting in front of the chicken house door. I was down at the feed room checking for coons when I heard him sound the alarm. I turned on my incredible speed and went tearing up the hill. I have several speeds, don't you know? Slow, normal, incredible. I saved the last one back for special emergencies. When I turn on incredible speed, I appear as a streak of color moving across the ground. Anything that gets in my way is knocked aside, often destroyed. I'm not talking about little stuff, neither. I mean trees, posts, big rocks, you name it. I was streaking up the hill and I met Drover.
Hank, I seen him. He's up there. Oh my gosh.
I had to slow down. Give me a description.
Hank, big. I mean big, huge, enormous. Black, white, gigantic tail that whistles through the air. A long pointed tongue that flicks out at you and has horns growing out the side of his head.
Good grief, I whispered. What is it? It's a monster, Hank. A genuine monster. I stopped to think it over. I never tangled with a monster before. You think I can whip him?
I don't know, Hank. But if anybody can, it's you.
You're right. Okay, here's the plan. I'll go on the first wave, make first contact. will hold you in reserve. If I holler for help, you come running in there with them teeth of yours and bite something. You got it? Got it. Took a deep breath and drove her. If I don't come back from this one, you'll have to go on alone. Take care of the ranch and be brave. That was kind of a touching moment. Me and Drover standing there in the moonlight just before the big battle. I said goodbye and I loped up the hill. I stopped and peered into the gloom. At first I couldn't see anything, but my eyes fell on a huge shadowy thing standing right in front of the chicken house door. Drover hadn't exaggerated. It was a horned monster, all right, and he was fixing to bust down the door and start killing chickens. I didn't have a moment to waste. It was now or never, me or him, glory or death. I bared my fangs and attacked. First contact was made only a matter of seconds after I launched the attack. The monster must have heard me coming because it kicked the tar out of me and sent me rolling. I leaped up and charged again, but this time I made it through and I sank my teeth into him and gave him a ferocious bite. He slung me around, but I hung on. He was big, all right, big as a house. I figured he stood 14 foot tall at the shoulder, had three eyes, forked tongue, and a tail with deadly stingers on the end of it, and horns that glowed in the dark, and tusks. Did I mention that? Big tusks coming out the side of his mouth, the kind that could rip a dog to shreds, with green slobber dripping out of his mouth, and his eyes were red. It was a fight to the death. Come on, Drover, attack! I set up the howl to alert the house. I would need all the help I could get. I'll give Drover credit. He come tearing out of the weeds, yapping at the top of his lungs, got within 3 feet of the monster before he veered off and headed for the machine shed. The lights come on down at the house. The door slammed and I heard Loper running toward me. I hope he had the gun. I was getting beat up and tired. I wasn't sure if I could keep up the fight much longer. The gun exploded, lit up the night. The monster ran, and I started after him, ready to give him the croup de grace, as we say. But Loper called me back. I figured he didn't want to risk losing the head of ranch security. Seemed pretty sensible to me. So I went back to him, limping on all four legs at once, because they all hurt. And so did everything else. Wagging my tail, I went up to him, ready for my reward. I didn't get no reward. To make a long story short, Drover had sent me into battle against the milk cow and I got cursed for it. I thought very seriously about terminating Drover. I mean his life, not his job. But I couldn't find him in the machine shed. So I dragged my battered carcass down to the gas tanks and curled up on my gunny sack bed. I could have sworn that was a monster.